of all the business owners and entrepreneurs, the crazy ones, the believers, the doers, the clever makers, the action takers, and everybody else in between, this podcast was designed for you. Welcome to a Business Growth Mindset Podcast. I'm Christian Lavolsi, and I am incredibly grateful to be here today and share this episode with you. In today's episode, I'm going to share with you why adaptability is a superpower and how to build your adaptive competitive advantage. It applies to students, corporates, tradies, CEOs, and entrepreneurs, and I know that it will help you grow and flourish. This podcast is about being extraordinary and living an outstanding life. It's filled with research, experience, examples, tips, and secrets for you to use on your journey. If this is your very first time listening to my podcast, welcome and thank you. I'm so glad that you have decided to hang out with me. Congratulations on making a powerful decision to invest in you. Now, please make sure that you subscribe to my, by clicking the subscribe button and change your notifications alert setting so you don't miss future episodes. Adaptability is a human skill regarded as one of the soft and essential skills of leaders. Now, as a society, there has been little historical emphasis on adaptability, but one thing COVID-19 has forced us to address is our ability to develop resilience and build adaptability. As leaders, we are all required to communicate, interact, negotiate, and think critically, but more importantly, the best leaders have mastered the skill to adapt to change and overcome resistance. Now, Charles Darwin said, "It is not the strongest of the species that survives, nor the most intelligent. It is the one that is most adaptable to change." Adaptability refers to one's ability to quickly respond to changing trends, innovation, destabilization, industry shifts, and so forth. Now, this ability to adjust or shift makes a business owner and CEO agile, and that is important because most industries today are in some state of unrest. Now, for example, let's consider a company whose business model has become disrupted by COVID and thus revenues dip. One business owner clings onto the standard way of doing business, resists change, and subsequently drags the company and its employees down towards catastrophic failure. Now, conversely, another business owner adapts by cutting costs, thinking differently, empowers their team, and most importantly, looks to the future and carves a new path, which carries the company forward through those tough times. In fact, companies led this way generally become more profitable and more connected than previously. Now, from my experience of working with hundreds of CEOs and business owners, adaptable leaders demonstrate 13 traits, and they are: they don't complain, they don't blame others or the circumstances that they are dealt, they have a growth mindset, they experiment. Number five, they see opportunity through failure. They are resourceful, okay? They think ahead, they are strategic, they are curious. Number 10, they have open minds. They focus on systems and processes. They stay relevant. And finally, they have a thirst for learning. Now, remember that all skills can be taught and you can develop these traits by practice and repetition. The best part about these traits is that you can teach your team, and great leaders focus on their team, empowering them with education and meaning. Now, where focus goes, energy flows. Invest in you and your team and grow and flourish through change and reduce resistance by being adaptable. There are three ways that I trained myself and others to be more adaptable, and they are: develop a growth mindset, become obsessed with learning, and my favorite, fail forward. Now, more on these throughout the podcast. I don't think, right, that anyone can argue that we don't live in uncertain times. In fact, I would go as far as saying that we live in a time of risk and instability. Now, many CEOs and business owners feel a deep sense of unease, which is caused by volatility of operating margins, shrinking talent, adoption of technology, globalizations, governments, cancel culture, and the pandemic, of course. Now, to further make this point, consider how precarious market leaderships have become. Now, companies are falling out of the top three in their categories more often than ever before, and there are many emerging companies with new and disruptive products pushing through. Now, once upon a time, there was a direct correlation between profitability and market share. However, this is almost non-existent in some sectors. Now, according to research by Harvard, there have been a significant decline where the market share and profitability leader are one of the same. Now, this decline is greater than 27%. It further suggests that many CEOs and business owners cannot clearly identify what industry they compete in and who their competitors really are. Now, what's obvious from the research and my observation working with hundreds of CEOs and business owners in Australia, Asia, and the US is that all this uncertainty is creating a tremendous challenge in strategy creation. Now, this is because traditional approaches to strategy were often seen to address the challenge of change and uncertainty, but this was grossly underpinned by the assumption of a relatively stable and predictable world. Now, the reality is that the world we once knew is no more, and things are different. More unpredictable, less stable, and of course, more uncertain. Now, this means that you can no longer depend on the traditional views, the established systems, predictable strategies, and thinking of the past. Now, you see, the goal of most strategies is to build an enduring competitive advantage through market positioning and establishing a niche for your products and services. And it's about assembling the right capabilities and competencies for making and delivering your products and services. Now, companies undertake periodic strategy reviews in order to evaluate progress, set direction, and define organizational structure. They do this based on industry analysis and some form of projected forecast. What's become obvious is with the rise of uncertainty, many CEOs and business owners are questioning the traditional practices. For example, I'm often approached with a series of the following questions from new clients. So, how do we apply existing frameworks? How do we measure position? How do we apply traditional forecasts and analyses? What are the right signals amongst all the confusion and chaos? Now, how do we minimize the impact of this unpredictability on our people? And how do we justify planning cycles of 3 years, let alone one, with all the rapid change? Now, it's important to make them realize that sustainable competitive advantage is no longer exclusively based on market-leading capabilities in production or delivery or scale or even position. In fact, these are now regarded as static. Now, essentially, it comes from your second order of capabilities driven by rapid adaptation. Now, the businesses who have a culture of learning and specifically those that love to learn how to do new things are outperforming those that are excellent at doing a few things particularly well. Now, collectively, there are four key capabilities to attain adaptive advantage, and they are read and act on signals, experimentation, and I refer this to failing forward, managing systems, and number four, mobilizing your people. You see, I help clients thrive by teaching them the skills, establishing the confidence, and providing them with the mindset that allows them to be quick to read and act on the signals of change. Now, this is fundamental in building adaptability in their culture. Now, we do this by establishing a culture of experimentation. We experiment frequently, economically, and rapidly. This is not limited to products and services. In fact, we stress test this on our business models, systems, processes, and most importantly, our strategies. We review systems and processes to make them agile and adaptable, and we automate. Now, we build skills and capabilities in the leaders and then have them filter it down to every person in the organization. The key is to activate the biggest and greatest resources in their business, that is, their people. Because I love providing you with massive value, we're going to take a deep dive into these four key capabilities that will help you build your adaptability superpower. So let's start. Read and act on change signals. Now, in order to adapt, a company must have its radar tuned for signals of change from the external environment. It must be able to decode them and quickly act to refine or reinvest its business model and even reshape the information landscape of its industry. So think back to when Juan Fangio was winning Formula One races and world championships. The car and the driver both determined who won. But today, the sport is as much about processing complex signals and making adaptive decisions as about mechanics and driving prowess. Now, they do this with hundreds of sensors built into the cars, and race teams continuously collect and process data on several thousand variables, ranging from weather and road conditions to the engine RPM and the angles of curves. And then they feed them into a dynamic simulation model that guides the driver's split-second decisions. A telemetric innovation by one team can instantly raise the bar for all. In this information-saturated age, when complex varying signals may be available simultaneously to all business owners, it is fundamental that CEOs and business owners have external advisors who can play critical roles in observation and can assist in developing adaptive companies by providing independence and clarity. Now, recently, I was engaged by a small retail organization to review their strategy. In our planning session, it became very obvious that they were not collecting valuable information and thus unable to leverage its power. Now, we quickly implemented changes to the point of sale system to ensure that they captured the right information. Within a matter of weeks, we were able to apply advanced data mining technologies to recognize relevant patterns in the data that we were collecting. And this provided us with an adaptive advantage. Now, companies are also leveraging their signal reading capabilities to make operational interventions in real time by bypassing slow-moving decision hierarchies. Google uses algorithms to update the position of an ad on the basis of the ad's relevance to an individual search or website, as well as the advertiser's bid on keywords. The more relevant an ad, the higher the click-through rate. And because the advertisers pay per click, this means more revenue for Google. By linking its advertising data directly to its operations, Google can respond to changing ad conditions on a split second basis without the intervention of human decision makers. Number two, experimentation. That which cannot be assumed or forecast can often be discovered through experimentation. Of course, all companies use some form of experimentation to develop and test new products and services. Yet, the traditional approaches can be costly and time-consuming and may lumber the organization with an unreasonable burden of complexity. Now, frustratingly, research based on consumer perceptions is often a remarkably poor forecaster of success. Now, the real world is an expensive medium for experimentation, and failed market tests and pilots can jeopardize a company's brand and reputation. Now, to overcome these barriers, a growing number of adaptive competitors are using an array of new approaches and technologies, especially in virtual environments. Now, to generate, test, and replicate a larger number of innovative ideas faster, at a lower cost, and with less risk than their rivals can. I was reading a paper recently that described how Procter & Gamble, through its Connect and Develop model, leveraged open innovation networks to solve technical design problems. It uses a walk-in 3D virtual store to run experiments that are quicker and cheaper than traditional market tests. And by employing online user communities, it can introduce and test products with friendly audiences before a full launch. In addition to changing the way in which they conduct experiments, companies need to broaden the scope of their experimentation. Traditionally, the focus has been on companies offering essentially new products and services. But in an increasingly turbulent environment, business models, strategies, and routines can also become obsolete quickly and unpredictably. Adaptive companies therefore use experimentation far more broadly than their rivals. For example, IKEA leverages existing assets and capabilities to experiment with business models. When IKEA entered new markets, the company noticed that the value of nearby real estate increased dramatically. So IKEA decided to explore two business models simultaneously: retailing through its stores and capturing the appreciation in real estate values through mall developments. Now, it now generates profit from developing and operating malls rather than just its traditional retail business. It's wonderful when you can recognize their experimentation certainly produces failure. Adaptive companies are tolerant of failure, even to the point of celebrating it. Now, for example, when I was the entrepreneur in residence at the University of Adelaide, we became extremely successful at using adaptive approaches to grow new businesses. And we built out rapid MVPs for startups to monetize. Now, these failed often, but quickly. And we fostered a culture of failing forward, which inevitably led to rapid design improvements and better market fit, which resulted in 66 startups raising $189 million in less than 12 months. Everyone understood that failure was only failure if we failed to get the learnings from each experiment. This attitude and mindset spawned greater innovation, adaptability, and character. Number three, managing systems. Now, signal detection and experimentation require CEOs and business owners to think beyond the company boundaries and perhaps to work more closely and smartly with customers and suppliers. Too often, I have observed the unspoken assumption that the unit of analysis for strategy is a single company or business unit. Now, with an increasing amount of economic activity occurring beyond corporate boundaries through outsourcing, offshoring, ecosystems, and even peer production, we need to think about strategies not only for individual companies, but also for dynamic business systems. Increasingly, industry structure is better characterized as competing webs or ecosystems of codependent companies rather than a handful of competitors producing similar goods and services and working on a stable, distant, and transactional basis with their suppliers and customers. In such an environment, advantage will flow to those CEOs and business owners whose companies can create effective strategies at the network or system level. Adaptive companies are therefore learning how to push activities outside the company without benefiting competitors and how to design and evolve strategies for networks without necessarily being able to rely on strong control mechanisms. Now, typically, adaptive companies manage their ecosystems by using common standards to foster interactions with minimal barriers. They generate trust among participants. Consider this. If the experience curve and the scale curve were the key indicators of success, well, Nokia would still be leading the smartphone market, but it was attacked by an adaptive ecosystem. It had the advantage of being an early mover and the market share leader with a strong cost position, but Nokia was attacked by an entirely different kind of competitor. Apple's adaptive system of supplier, telecom partnerships, and numerous independent application developers created to support the iPhone. Google's Android operating system, too, capitalized on a broad array of hardware partners and application developers. Now, the ability to bring together the assets and capabilities of so many entities allowed these smartphone entrants to leapfrog the experience curve and become a new market leader in record time. Now, Stephen Elop, Nokia's CEO, wrote in a memo to staff, "Our competitors aren't taking our market share with devices, they are taking our market share with an entire ecosystem." Now, it's critical to recognize that through broader signal detection, parallel innovation, superior flexibility, and rapid mobilization, multi-company systems can enhance the adaptiveness of individual companies, but this requires leadership from the CEO and business owner, which fosters a cultural shift. And number four, mobilizing people. Adaption is essentially narrow in nature. Somebody experiments first at a particular place and time. It is also unavoidably global in nature, because if the experiment succeeds, it will be communicated, selected, amplified, and refined. CEOs and business owners need to create environments that encourage the knowledge flow, diversity, autonomy, risk-taking, sharing, and flexibility on which adaption thrives. A flexible structure and spreading of decision privileges are powerful levers for increasing adaptability. You can replace permanent silos and functions with modular units that freely communicate and recombine according to situations at hand. To reinforce this framework, it is helpful to have weak or even competing power structures and a culture of constructive conflict and dissent. As you create more fluid structures, you can drive decision-making down to the front lines, allowing the people most likely to detect changes in the environment to respond quickly and proactively. Creating fluid and even competing organizational structures destroys the big advantage of rigid hierarchy, whereby everyone knows precisely what he or she should be doing. An adaptive company can't expect to succeed unless it provides people with some substitute for that certainty. What's needed is some simple, generative rules to facilitate interaction, help people make trade-offs, and set the boundaries within which they can make decisions. Now, for example, Netflix values 9 core behaviors and skills in its people. 1, judgment, communication, impact, curiosity, innovation, courage, passion, honesty, and 9, selflessness. They believe that a great workplace is full of stunning colleagues who embody these qualities. Thus, the Netflix model is to increase employee freedom as we grow rather than limit it, to continue to attract and nourish innovative people so that we have a better chance of long-term success. Now, consistent with this philosophy, Netflix has only 2 types of rules. Those designed to prevent irrevocable disaster and those designed to prevent moral, ethical, and legal issues. It has no vacation policy and does not track time. The company's focus is on what needs to get done, not how many hours or days are worked. And that is powerful. Netflix calls this their reference guide on freedom and responsibility culture and sums it up with a very powerful statement: avoid chaos as you grow with ever more high-performance people, not with rules. Now, for many CEOs and business owners, becoming an adaptive company can be difficult, especially for those large, well-established and set in their way companies. These companies are typically orientated towards managing efficiency and scale, and they have rigid hierarchical structures and fixed routines which provide a lack of diversity and agility required for rapid learning and change. These leaders and their companies die hard, especially when traditional processes and strategy have been the basis of their success. Now, before I continue, I want to thank you for staying with me during this podcast. I must say, this has been one of my favorites so far because it's packed with value that I have witnessed and experienced firsthand. By now, at least half of our listeners have dropped off, but stay with me, because if you are one of the many CEOs and business owners that is struggling with a traditional approach, uncertain times, and complexity that is holding you back and forcing you to remain stuck, then this next part is for you. Let me be very clear, you don't have to die hard. In fact, I'm going to share with you right now a handful of tactics that you can adopt to establish an adaptive culture and build adaptive advantage. These tactics have been proven in the field, and we implement them in our clients' businesses and embed them in their culture. These form the building blocks to building sustainable gazelle companies. One, look at the disruptors. Rapid growth industries often have the presence of disruptive rebels. Generally, they are new and sometimes from other industries. They are not pigeonholed in their approach, and nor do they have the traditionalist views of heavily conforming and established heavyweights. Now, by observing these mavericks, you can form new thinking, adapt their tools, leverage their risk, and adaptability. Now, more importantly, look across other industries and markets that are adjacent or even parallel to yours and apply the hypotheses of what if these disruptors entered my industry, then what would happen to me? Now, this scenario type planning affords you deep critical thinking, which often results in identifying risk, challenges, and opportunities. Noting that pattern recognition is more difficult in uncertain circumstances and can be obstructed by ingrained beliefs and industry definitions, it does provide valuable competitive advantages. Now, recognize and take action on the uncertainties is number three. Now, you need to put aside the traditional single business forecast and examine the risk and uncertainties that could impact your company. Now, this exercise alone will force you to determine what you don't know and how to address it. This is your opportunity to identify questionable assumptions, those false unknowns that you may have recognized or even taken action on without any speed or emphasis. Now, furthermore, you can also categorize those hedged bets that you prepared for your uncertain time. Now, number four is one of my favorites. It's increase the speed. Now, I talk about speed a lot, and the fundamental truth is there is no substitute for speed, and absolutely none. Speed of adoption is critical in the cycle of decision-making. Imperfect action trumps perfect inaction every time. You need to accelerate change by making planning lighter, more frequent, and making the intermittent process constant. Make risk and initiative is number five, okay? Adaptability must become your engine that drives your company. It starts with you as the CEO or business owner. Every source of uncertainty must be addressed with an initiative. Now, the goal is to respond to a neglected trend, create an opportunity, or simply learning more about it. You must be disciplined in metrics, timeframes, and responsibility to ensure accountability and action. And then lastly, always seek alternatives. In stable environments, it's easy to become complacent and merely look for small improvements to existing circumstances. By simply requiring that each suggestion is met with several alternatives will force your people to become more varied, create a powerful movement for innovation and creativity. But it also legitimizes and fosters cognitive diversity and flexibility. Today, we are faced with an uncertain and competitive reality that is forced by rapid change and disruption. It's not enough to simply survive and ride the wave using traditionalist approaches and fixed mindsets. Instead, I encourage you to use this dynamic and sustainable adaptive way to stay ahead so you can thrive. You must exploit the four key capabilities that I talked about today, and I'm going to recap them. Read and act on change signals, experimentation, managing systems, and mobilizing your people. To attain an adaptive and advantage and thrive, that is critical. So here's my thing, why wait? Why not just decide to grow your business with this proven strategy and live your best life? Raise your standards and step up. Today's your day, it's your life, it's your legacy, and you can build adaptability right now. All you need to do is make a decision to become adaptable. Make a decision to develop the traits and implement the skills in your everyday life. And here's the best part. You don't have to do it alone. You can achieve and be fulfilled and live with passion and purpose every single day. So this is your time to decide. Join me and live your best life. For me, this is about being in a peak state. And if you don't know how, connect with me on LinkedIn, where I share content almost every single day, and immerse yourself and raise your standards. Step up and make your move right now. Follow and engage with me on social platforms and sign up to my new monthly insights. When you're ready to make your move and grow your business to the next level and raise your standards, go to the link in the show notes or go to one of my sites and book a free strategy call with me. On this call, we can explore where you're at, where you want to go, and how we can do so together, helping you achieve your goals faster, better, and more fulfillingly. I have loved hanging out with you today and showing you why adaptability is a superpower and how to build your adaptive competitive advantage. I hope that you found the information that I shared with you today encouraging and that you can use it to show up, stand up, raise your standards, and step up in life. If you love today's episode, please take a minute to rate it and provide a review. While you're there, take a minute to share this episode with your networks and give the gift of knowledge to others. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. And until next time, live with purpose.